Good morning, everyone. Dear friends in Christ, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, our Comforter. I want to welcome you and thank you, both those who are here and those watching through live stream, for giving of your time to share in this Thanksgiving service as we give thanks to God for the life and ministry of Frank Anderson. Although numbers are limited in this church building due to the restrictions of COVID-19, there are many watching as we go live through the internet, and I'm sure Frank's family appreciate your presence. It also serves as a source of comfort to them. We are coming to you live from Canterbury Baptist Church in the eastern suburbs of Melbourne. My name is Gerald Vanderwert. I'm the senior pastor at Donville Presbyterian Church, where Frank worshipped originally with Lewis and then with Margaret since they were married for just over 5 years ago. Friends, another chapter is closed. Another fight has been fought. Another race has been won. Our help is in the name of the Lord, our Creator and our Redeemer, and the one who will give life to our mortal bodies when we pass from this world. To him be praise and honor and glory forever. It's a sad time when we come to say our final farewells to someone like Frank, who was a loved and valued member of his family, friends, and the people of God in his church. I speak as his pastor and friend, and I would highlight his godliness and graciousness from my knowledge of him. Both Margaret and Frank were faithful attendees at Donville Presbyterian, sitting in the first two aisle seats of the second row, right under the pulpit and within my gaze when leading or preaching on a Sunday morning. Frank was, in my words, a Barnabas, a man who had words of encouragement and praise about my ministry and my preaching, and not just mine, but the other pastors as well, Jordan Bourne, my assistant, and Clinton LePage, who's here this morning and worked with me at Donville until a couple of years ago. It was my privilege to be Frank's pastor and to get to know him, together with Margaret, and prior to that, with Lois. I should say that when I preached from passages such as the book of Job, that it took longer in preparation. I had visions of Frank during my preparation, moving me to do a bit more work on my message and to consult his commentary on the passage. Yes, he was a scholar who made a significant contribution, especially to the Hebrew text of the Old Testament, of which I'm sure we will hear more about during the service. Frank's going to be missed by our people at Donville, together with Margaret now, as she intends to move back to Toowoomba in the coming weeks. They were loved and cared for by the people of the congregation, who appreciated their love for people and their gracious manner towards them. Together with my assistant, Pastor Jordan, I visited Frank the night before he received his home call, and I prayed with him. And in my prayer, I quoted the words of the Lord Jesus, and I said, "Frank, Jesus says, 'My peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself.'" And it is to that same Lord Jesus that we turn this morning, who grants us his peace. We give him the prize for his work of grace in the life of Frank Anderson, and for using Frank to extend the kingdom of Christ for the glory of Christ's name. Friends, God has accomplished his purpose in the life of Francis Ian Anderson, and to him be praise forever. Amen. Bishop Paul Barker. Thank you, Paul.
Candles have symbolized the bringing of light into the darkness over the centuries. Christ is the light that shines in the darkness, who illuminates everyone who comes to him. And in turn, we pass the light of Christ on to others. In lighting candles together now, we symbolize how the light that originally came from Christ has illuminated our lives through Frank. We'll have a lighting of candles here in the church, but many of you watching this video may also have a candle to light during this time. And as we have these candles lit, hear these words from the prologue of the Gospel of John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not understood it. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not receive him. It did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children not born of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
I'm Ted Newing, and I'm lighting this candle to celebrate the life of a dear friend and colleague, Francis Ian Anderson, and to give thanks to God for him.
In memory of Frank Anderson, friend of many years and sorely missed.
I'm lighting this candle in the honor of Sean's papa.
Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Father God, we thank you for Frank. We thank you for his desire to bring your word to your people with ever increasing clarity and with enthusiasm. Father, we thank you for him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Friends, we take comfort from the Word of God as he speaks into our lives. I want to read to you a few words of Scripture. Firstly, from the lips of the Lord Jesus, from John 11. He said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet will they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." And then some words from Job chapter 19, verse 25, well-known words. "I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he shall stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. How my heart yearns within me." Please join with me as we say the words of prayer on the printed sheet. Loving God, you alone are the source of life. May your life-giving spirit flow through us and fill us with compassion, one for another. In our sorrow, give us the calm of your peace. Kindle our hope and let our grief give way to joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then words from the Apostle Paul from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50 to 55. He says, "I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true, death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting?" Amen. Deb Anderson, thanks, Deb.
Hello, I'm Deborah Anderson, Frank Anderson's daughter-in-law. On Sunday, the 3rd of May, Papa, that is Frank, was in hospital. COVID-19 severely restricted our opportunities as a family to visit him. So we set up a group video call where Papa could at least see and greet his family members. Afterwards, though he was exhausted and in pain, he was very much stimulated by the contact of family. and his spirits revived, and he talked about the church creeds, the nature of God, Augustine, and the Gospel of John. I invite you to listen to Popper as I did by his bed that day. And may these words be living words.
But this is where Augustine just broke. He broke the mold.
Mm-hmm.
He broke the mold.
Mm-hmm.
What is the relationship between the Father and the Son? He had a text. Don't you realize that I love the Father and the Father loves me? There's your theology.
Mm-hmm.
Love.
Mm-hmm.
Persons.
Mm-hmm.
Personal names like Father. Mm-hmm. Personal relationship. Mm-hmm. Father, Son. You've got a lot to work on there.
Mm.
And this is even more wonderful. More wonderful.
Mm.
If the Father loves the Son,
mm-hmm.
and the Son loves the Father,
mm.
now you know all about love. If A loves B, if John loves them,
mm-hmm.
what does John do? John pours his love into your heart. He puts you first. What do? You respond with personal love. You pour your love into his life. And you put him first. So this is where the contradiction of this. If you say that A is in B, B is more important than A. So, on one statement, the Father is more important than the Son.
Mm-hmm.
The Son is more important than the Father.
Mm.
In their own perception of each other, united. Now you've got material to talk about. What do you mean by glory? Shining radiance, full of light and energy.
Mm.
Personal warmth.
Mm.
So, you see, they never, talking about proceeding, the Holy Spirit's an active person.
Mm.
So that's where, if you'll give me another 100 years, that I could write an amateurish paper called The Son Revealed the Father. Here's the Father. Just John's Gospel. But, you see, where it can't go, where it's stuck, a perfect substance, by definition, a perfect substance is unchangeable.
Oh.
If it improves, it wasn't changed.
But this isn't fitting scripture, is it?
No.
It's philosophical ideas.
You see, that's in the first article of the prayer book, one true living God, who is a substance.
Yes.
So, but you see, then you say the substance can never change. Because if it diminishes, it's not, it wasn't perfect. If it improves, it wasn't perfect. It's stuck. It's frozen in his own perfection. And it means that if God cannot change into anything else, then you can't believe the most important statement in the New Testament. Logos sux egeneton. The Logos became flesh. Logos is not the same as flesh. God became something different. that he wasn't. And that is where, you see, and what is the nature of the becoming?
Mm.
When the God, the Logos, the eternal Logos, becomes flesh.
Mm.
Called in the Gospel of John, a man. Jesus is a man.
Mm.
I read the latest book of Reformed theology by an American.
Mm.
Jesus, he says, Jesus was not a human being. When you, and of course, the super duper conservatives don't like the way the liberals emphasize the humanity of Jesus. You know, the fundamentalists accuse the liberal that he didn't believe in the divinity of Christ.
Mm.
And the man was outraged. He said, oh, I've never denied the divinity of any man. So,
yeah.
What will I do? I die.
Yes, you've got to tackle something there.
You see, if you're John.
Yes.
I see, because the text in the New Testament is that that Christ, the Son of God, emptied himself, humiliated himself, and took on the persona of a slave. He who was rich, yet for our sake, became poor.
Mm-hmm.
He who knew no sin, God made him to become sin for us.
Mm.
Now, that is the minority opinion, because it contradicts the immutability of God and says, God, you're going to say, everything's possible for God. He can shrink himself to the dimensions of a human being.
Sounds like Alice in Wonderland.
Yes, I know. But you see, that's where it is. If Jesus is in God, he's reduced to a lower level. The Father is in Christ, he's reduced to a lower level. And you see, you've got to recognize that this emptying is not just an act that happened to bring about the incarnation.
Mm.
The emptying is in the innermost reality of the Holy Trinity as three persons. In all the divine energy of eternal life, emptying themselves into one another in a ceaseless dance.
Oh.
That's love.
Right.
You can see that. One of the statements in the New Testament, God is love, period. Whereas that's not in any theological system. And yet, Deb, what are you going to tell anyone about God?
God is love.
In every breath of your body, you will say what the New Testament says. God is love. And of course, it is this fiery, energetic, mysterious, complex, personal being that is God. Fascinating. Incredible. Unimaginable. Indescribable, but adorable, a worshipper. You know, look, Father and Son. You've got all that's good about a Father for Jesus and for all of us. You've got a Son in this wonderful relationship with the Father, into which he then brings us as co-sons with God. Mm. We're taken right into the heart of God, which is the heart of love. That's the gospel. Mm. That's not the way it's preached. See what I mean?
Mm.
Hello, Unius Libri.
Yeah.
And, well, who cares? Man, if you're John, if we got together, we could produce a real blockbuster of a book.
I'm Joy Marshall. I'm Frank Anderson's youngest stepdaughter. And now we hear some more words from Frank. Oh, you can't hear me? All right. Okay. Some more words from Frank. An epithalamion written for Margaret. And for those of you like myself who are not familiar with Greek, that means a bridal song. As three candles leaning together make one pure flame. As the holy three embracing in love a one radiant vehement glory, so a woman and a man, a flame in love with God and with each other, are joined and embraced by a third, the tremendous lover. Four eyes, four lips, four arms, two hearts and other parts merge and melt into one flesh within the arms and heart of God, who joins them in their joyful holy love. Heaven lies around us in our old age. We live in it already. We see it in a glass clearly. And trailing clouds of glory, we return to God, who is our home. From earth, which is our home, and God's home with us. We are at home with our Father, now here, soon there. There is only one eternal life. We live it already. The one life of Father, Spirit, Son, the life God generously gives, pouring into us the life of our lives, the amazing love of our loves. Yes.
I'm John Anderson. I am Frank's number one son. I would like to convey from Frank's oldest brother, Ronald Evans, who is not able to be with us this morning, his own words and reflections upon his brother, Frank. Hello. I am Ronald Evans, Francis Ian's eldest brother, and the only one of seven of us still alive. We grew up in Warwick on the Darling Downs. Our home was on the banks of the Condamine River. Over the road was the flour mill. Our Danish grandparents lived over the river across the paddock. When I was in Melbourne for my 98th birthday this year, I visited Frank and we reminisced about our growing up. Over the last couple of weeks, I've been thinking about family times, particularly with Frank. Mother was a seamstress and made all our clothes. Sunday best was black shorts, white shirt, and a black ribbon bow tie. Emil, that's father, managed the store in Yangan, a small town 20 kilometers east of Warwick. We helped out there by weighing flour and sugar and other goods and packing them into paper bags ready for sale. Sometimes we'd do the delivery in the tray back truck. Emil was a teetotaler, but smoked, and later developed cancer of the lip. One day we pinched his papers and some of his tobacco and went to meet with other boys from school to have a smoke under the Victoria Street Bridge one afternoon after school. That day, as we went through Granddad's gate, he came out to have a chat. We never did learn to smoke. We did enjoy calling at the grandparents' house, as there was usually fresh-baked biscuits for afternoon tea. And we would sit on the veranda and talk while Johannes Sophus would grind the beans for fresh coffee, the Danish way. During the Depression, as the wheat was unloaded from the 5-bushel bags at the flour mill, some flour spilled onto the railway line. It was Frank's and my job to collect it to feed our chooks and ducks. Shopping days for the farmers would see the sulkies whizzing around town. Frank was dreamily wandering along one day and was hit by one. He ended up with a fractured femur, resulting in one leg shorter than the other. On cross-country day, Frank was coming around for his fourth lap. There was much cheering as Frank was coming first, but the lad behind him was on his fifth lap. Frank remembered that in the race. I cut under the bridge instead of going right round. We grew up in a Christian home and worshipped at the Methodist Church. Frank did not follow father's and grandfather's footsteps regarding joining the Masonic Lodge. Over time, Frank and I have had many discussions about this topic. In the mid-1950s, I had an army posting to Pakapanyo. Saturdays saw us driving down to Melbourne. Afternoons were often spent visiting my brothers, either the John Anderson family, that's not me, but my uncle, or the Frank Anderson family. When Frank and Lois moved to the States, they always kept in touch and sent presents to our girls. I wasn't that good in reciprocating. Mavis and I enjoyed family times again when Frank and Lois moved to Brisbane for a time. Brother Frank was a good brother to me. We often engaged in conversations that could be soul-searching or just how to solve the world's problems. Frank often said that he was just a barefoot country lad, but he traveled the world, mixed with world leaders, but was just Brother Frank when he was with family. Our grandfather was head gardener for Warwick Parks and Gardens. And you, Frank, have followed in his footsteps by living the life of a servant, laboring in God's garden. Thank you, Ron, for your kind words. Now, I would like to speak. My very first memory was crossing the concrete stormwater culvert at the end of our backyard in Baltimore to explore the beech forest on the other side with my father holding my hand. And a sense of wonder and excitement that I had of a whole new world to explore. My last time with Dad was holding his hand. While he stood at the culvert of death on the threshold of exploring the whole new world that lay on the other side. It was a journey that I could not accompany him on. many people had the privilege of calling Francis Frank. I had the privilege of calling him Dad. Dad was the single most influential man in my life, and he leaves a huge legacy. Dad was devoted to his work, yet he was not a perfectionist. He repeatedly told me, "Something worth doing is worth doing badly." I translated that into, "Give it your best shot." Dad worked during the week, but he made a very deliberate decision that weekends were family time. When we were growing up in Berkeley, California, Dad would bake bread, make pizzas, cook chicken on Saturdays, and we would have family picnics on Sundays in the hills behind our home. As parents, my mom and dad worked as a team. Dad would quip, "Lois is the head of the house, I am the head of the wife." And that is how they operated. Mom was involved with us on a day-to-day basis, but Dad was ultimately in charge. As a husband, Dad was devoted to my mother. I remember Dad many times kissing Mom on the top of her petite head, and I quietly determined to myself, "I'm going to marry a woman of my own height." And I did. Lois was a pediatrician, but Dad introduced her to his world in California. And that led to both Mom and Dad teaching as colleagues at New College, Berkeley. Now, my wife and I are both psychologists, working as colleagues at Mount Evelyn Counseling Center. Legacy. I cannot fathom the importance of the legacy that Dad left me in the quality of the devoted marriages that he modeled first with Lois and more recently with Margaret. He demonstrated how you treat a woman. Theological legacy. My father made no academic separation between his theology and his personal spirituality. His secret as a scholar was that Dad only had a personal living theology. I had the unique privilege of having Dad as my informal supervisor during my Master of Theology, followed by my PhD. Dad consistently emphasized, "You have to read the text." When I first started sharing the ideas of my thesis with Dad, he sternly rebuked me. "If it is not biblical, I cannot support you." And I was presented with the challenge that to establish my thesis, I had to convince my father that it was really based on the text. But as we worked with the text, our discussions led us to developing our theology in new ways, which, as you have just heard, can be summed up in Dad's principle in dogmatics. Church doctrine must be derived from Scripture rather than the interpretation of Scripture being driven by doctrine. Dad never regarded theology as something to camp around to be theologically correct. Rather, he enjoyed exploring new ideas right until the day that he died. Spiritual legacy. For me, it is summed up in the word integrity. James wrote, "Faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by what I do." Dad consistently lived his faith in his private life at home. There was no hypocrisy in him. He was a righteous man, both morally and in the care and respect with which he treated people, ranging from the lady at the supermarket checkout to engaging in genuine dialogue with people with a different theological persuasion to his own. Regularly, each morning, Dad would have a large cup of coffee and sit in his favorite chair reading his Bible. When I was a kid, we indulged in a game where we would select an Old Testament verse by random, say Isaiah 43:6, and Dad would state it in Hebrew, then translate it, and he would get it right. I learned from that, John, know your Bible. It is no point just having it on paper. You need to have it in your head. Frank was not just my father. He became my mentor and my close friend. And I will miss him.
When I think of Dad, I think of his humour, all those whimsical sayings that were so typical of him. She who must be obeyed. A simple but nourishing meal. Sleep that knits up the ravel sleeve of care. I think of books everywhere. His theology. But as I thought deeper, I realised the thing that was stood out about Dad was that he invited us into his world. Dad discovered cooking when we were in Berkeley, and he got into making bread and pizzas. And every Saturday, we would make about a dozen pizzas, and each one of us had a job. And my job was to put on the grated cheese. And at Christmas time, Dad would make Christmas fruit cakes for people. And my job was to put on the paper around the tin and to decorate it. He also invited us into his world of music, symphony concerts at the Opera House. He used to accompany me when I played the violin or when I was learning Italian opera, and he'd play the piano. And who could forget his love of Mozart's perfection or Bach's inspiration? He invited us into his work. Dad took us all over the world when he traveled to Israel, to the UK, to Papua New Guinea. And he even asked us to help him proofread his commentaries. So Hosea, Micah. And as for his colleagues, well, at dinner parties at our place, you wouldn't know if you would have a monk from Russia, a theologian from the Middle East, or the head of the English department. And who could forget Dad's lion chair? I think that Mum almost gave up getting Dad a study when we moved to different houses because he would have her study lined with books, but he would never use it as a study. He would always come out and sit in his big chair with a board across and then books on either side because he wanted to be part of where the family was and he wanted us to be part of what he was doing. His books, Dad read up to us the Narnia stories when we grew up. And he also recorded on reel-to-reel tape the entire Lord of the Rings. And we listened to it as we traveled across America in the 1960s. And of course, Dad invited us to play 500 with him. But how did he do this? How did he ask us to join in his journey of life and of faith? Well, he would share his ideas, and if you followed his meanderings, you would always come up with a place that was awesome and interesting. But he would listen to our ideas and our reflections, and he would ask questions. And he would ask, what does the text say? What does the gospel say about this? And he would invite us to ask questions and invite our comments. And he was never dismissive. He was never arrogant. He was never patronizing. He never made you feel stupid. He always welcomed us. He would listen. He would value our ideas, and he wanted our company. And he would light up when people would talk to him or phone him. And I was discussing this with my family, and my son came up with a perfect example the other night. Michael was saying he has this lovely memory of Popov asking him to play 500 with him when he was 9. And they launched into an 8-spades bid. And Michael just went in there, and he just loved the fact that Dad expected and wanted him to be part of that. And this all crystallized the other day when our pastor was having a sermon on John 15, and he was reflecting on how Jesus chose his disciples to be fruitful. And I realized that God also chose us before creation to be part of his plan and part of his kingdom. And I realized that when Dad asks us to join in his life and his faith and his journey, he is modeling what our Heavenly Father does for us by asking us to join in what he's doing on this earth. So I'm going to miss Dad. I'm going to miss his wisdom, his ideas, his humor, his questions, his cooking, playing cards with him, his kindness and tenderness. But I am so grateful that he has been a model for me of what our Heavenly Father is like with us.
Greeting everyone, and especially to Frank's immediate family gathered in Melbourne. It's sad not to be able to be with you in person, but good to be able to connect in this mediated way. The death of Francis Ian Anderson is a great loss on many levels. I'll touch on just two. First, this loss is far-reaching. Frank was an outstanding linguist, a creative biblical exegete, an imaginative theologian, a challenging teacher. Researchers, readers, listeners, students, conversation partners around the globe have all felt, as I have, the exhilarating gravitational pull of Frank's sheer intellectual brilliance. Whether he was addressing the nature of the Hebrew verbless clause in the Pentateuch, or the significance of C.S. Lewis's Narnia stories, or the modal tendencies in Karl Barth's reinterpretation of the Trinity, or the strange implications of the fact that when God finally agreed to Job's agonized plea for an audience, God gave him a lesson in natural history and gave it to him in poetry. Whatever it was, Frank's passionate and exhilarating explorations were offered to us freely, not to ensnare others in orbit around himself, but precisely for the opposite reason, to encourage us, using his deep understanding as a platform, to launch into the trajectories of our own vocations in life, whatever they might have been. In mourning Frank, we enter a spacious place, and a lot of people are here with us from all parts of the world. But the loss is not only wide, it is also deep. Frank was a great scholar, but more than that, he was a man of grace, humor, love, a man of faith and prayer. I met him first when he entered the orbit of our family through the courtship of his beloved Lois, my father's sister, in the early 1950s. Frank had a big impact on me when I first went to the university. It was a time of skepticism about faith in God, would you believe, especially in the sciences which I was studying. And Frank spent many an hour listening to my muddled and naive questions, not trying to answer my doubts, but offering me resources to search for my own answers. Across my life, I owe him a great deal for those kinds of challenging and transformative conversations. And I know I'm not alone in that. And then there was his infectious humor. Who could forget that room-filling laugh when Frank pulled off an unlikely misère in a game of 500 to drag his floundering team from the brink of defeat to the very threshold of victory? Or his down-to-earth involvement in day-to-day family life. I remember when he was a revered professor of Old Testament studies in Berkeley, California. His amazing persistence in the unforgiving art of baking sourdough bread. When, once again, after all the ingredients carefully weighed, painstakingly sieved, endlessly kneaded, lovingly rested, and precisely sculpted, emerged from the oven the color, shape, and relative density of a brick, Frank kept on until he nailed it, just because the family loved sourdough bread and he loved giving it to them. The Hebrew verbless clause in the Pentateuch and sourdough bread in Berkeley. That was Frank. And our sadness today is wide and deep because Frank's presence in our lives was wide and deep. And now Frank has moved dramatically in relation to us. But his move is within, not outside the love of God. Frank has joined that great cloud of witnesses of which the book of Hebrews speaks. He has become a true ancestor for us, not one who recedes ever farther into a receding past, but one who has gone ahead of us into God's future, and from there calls us still to the vocations that make our lives. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you, dear Frank, and with us all.
I wish to bring greetings from the Anglican Diocese of Melbourne, though we're in a Baptist church. And in recent years, Frank has attended a Presbyterian church. He was nonetheless an ordained Anglican minister, ordained as a priest in the St. Paul's Cathedral in Melbourne a long time ago, before I was born. And I bring you greetings and condolences from Archbishop Philip Freer, who knew Frank, but is unable to be here today. And so I represent the Diocese of Melbourne in bringing greetings today. But I do so with personal affection as well, because for nearly 10 years, I suspect, Frank was a parishioner of mine at Holy Trinity Doncaster when I was the vicar there in the late 90s and into the 2000s. My first encounter with Frank is probably my favourite. I was told that he was going to start attending Holy Trinity Doncaster. This was 1996 or 7. And I was in the middle of a sermon series on the book of Amos. I was not as brave as Gerald. I never preached on Job when Frank was a parishioner of mine. However, Frank was the co-author of perhaps the longest English language commentary on the book of Amos. And as he left the church and shook hands as I stood at the door, he said words that I've never forgotten. He said, "You said in 30 minutes what it took me 200 pages to say." Frank, typically gracious and kind, and I enjoyed the times that he was a parishioner of mine, with Lois, of course, over those years. And my sympathy to you all, his family.
Thank you, Paul. Psalm 23 was written by King David, because David knew God as his shepherd, as indeed all those who know God through Christ today can sing and say these words. We're going to stand and sing Psalm 23, "The Lord is my shepherd."
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to green, he leadeth me. The quiet waters by, my soul he doth restore again, and me to walk doth make with him for his own name's sake.
but still.
I'm Andrew Reed, and I first came to know Frank through my wife, Heather. Heather was a university student studying physiotherapy, and Frank was at Macquarie University. Heather attended a Christian Union camp she had heard of, where Frank was the speaker. And Frank's goal for the weekend was to help the group read the Book of Habakkuk using manuscript discovery. And this weekend changed Heather's attitude to the Old Testament. She realised that the Old Testament was not a mystery, that she could read it for herself. And her life was changed. She's now engaged in Old Testament doctoral studies herself, and she has spent 20 years training young women to read the Bible for themselves. My own experience of Frank came after Heather's, but it too goes back a long way. I was in my mid to late 20s, an Anglican minister who'd discovered student ministry and been made General Secretary of the Australian Fellowship of Evangelical Students. Like all good General Secretaries, I embarked on visiting each state in Australia, and when it came to Brisbane, the locals decided that I should stay with the Andersens. I did so knowing nothing about Frank except two things. One, his famous IBP commentary on Job, and two, what Heather had told me. I walked into the Anderson home. I was warmly welcomed, and from then on, I listened and learnt. You see, here was one of Australia's most able biblical scholars, a man of renown, someone whose knowledge was voluminous, but a man who humbly spoke to me as a fellow student of the scriptures. We became firm friends, and in the week I had at the Anderson household, we talked together, we prayed together, and we thought about great things together. And then as the years passed, we crossed paths occasionally. We exchanged emails. In my late 50s, I became the local Anglican rector in Doncaster. Our friendship was renewed. And I would regularly visit, and Frank would again feed me with ideas and questions. And occasionally, for my part, I would give him communion using the Anglican prayer book. And we'd pray together. We would talk about dying. And Frank didn't fear death, for he knew his Saviour. He loved Jesus, his Lord. And I, for my part, am grateful for his love, care, and interest that extended over 40 years.
Who's also a grandson. I have Tyria on my left and Lindsay as well, and we're all grandchildren of Papa. This is a song which he requested to have performed, and so we're here to honour his wishes.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Francis Ian Anderson, life-changing friend and singular scholar. To the family, I offer my heartfelt condolences. I'm honored to participate today. Naturally, Frank's passing has revived many a recollection involving him. His days married counting ritual, our many productive working walks over the years, the two couples' provenance, exploration, and on and on. Rather than talk about these matters, I prefer to focus on something central to his work life, his approach to biblical research. Our paths first intersected just over 50 years ago at the Graduate Theological Union, where he taught me biblical Hebrew philology, first as a consultant on heart research at Hewlett-Packard Laboratories, and later as a research scientist. I had access to the lab computer and was given permission to use it whenever it was not required for company research. Frank and I therefore were able to begin our studies of biblical Hebrew syntax on weekends. In addition to his amazing knowledge of the biblical texts, Frank knew the scholarly literature in great depth. This greatly facilitated our work together. In addressing any problem, he was dissatisfied until he had mastered all its associated data and had accounted for corner cases, that is, data that seemingly did not fit in somewhere. In the book manuscript that he was working on in his final days, he wrote, "I have carried out my research in the belief that every difference in language use makes a difference, that every detail, however seemingly slight, might well be significant. I accept the reproach that I have a pedantic obsession with minutiae." That was always Frank's initial stance. The data could move him, but only for strong due cause. Fortunately, the advent of computers brought access, display, and management of vast amounts of data into reach. But mastery of the data, his mastery, rested on his legendary powers of concentration and his ability somehow to organize the data en masse, contradictory interpretations and all. The computer also simplified rabbit chasing, a sport that he loved to play. This was his way, I believe, of honing and testing his intuitions. Whether due to his nature or due to his extensive training in science, Frank was suspicious of the facile theory, the welcome result. He distrusted the fashionable. He struggled to identify central issues while avoiding the dangers of oversimplification. He delighted in new ideas and problems. He loved spontaneously to share discoveries with colleagues. Ignoring that such sharing was frowned upon in some academic circles as showing off, he happily, yea, gleefully, shared his ideas. Many a time, he mischievously asserted claim to this or that great discovery. Has no one noticed before that such and such is the case? In our decades of collaboration, not once did Frank suggest that a result be suppressed. Very occasionally, he did wryly observe that publication of a result likely would attract sharp condemnation, but so be it. In his final months, mercifully, he retained recall of fundamentals, as well as his ability to propose rescues for stymied work and to recognize and appreciate excellent work. He ever sought to identify and encourage up-and-coming scholars. He began many a conversation by asking, "Have you seen the latest paper by so-and-so? She, he is doing some important work." Francis Ian Anderson was a remarkable enlarger of biblical scholarship. Hermann Hesse's poem well expresses Frank's approach to research. And those of us who trust ourselves the least, who doubt and question most, these, it may be, will make their mark upon eternity.
A poem written by Frank Anderson. Duet at Dawn. I love you, Yahweh, and with merry mind and singing hands, shout, joy, you are my joy. My every muscle, voice to toes, vibrates with love that bursts with everything you do. That flower, red, against the sky of blue, captures my eye. And suddenly you're there, singing your silent colour song to share my joy, so gentle and so humorous. The kookaburra knows our secret fun. His laughter makes the first prayer of my day. A concert which we hope you will applaud. You must be quite hilarious yourself to think up such a ridiculous pair of happy creatures telling you a joke.
My name is Noel Hickson, and I recall my first meeting with the newly accredited Dr. Frank Anderson in my second year at Ridley College in Melbourne. His warm greeting of this humble theological student was fantastic in the extent of its warmth and friendliness. His lectures were, to say the least, different. His extensive knowledge of detail blew my mind. My interest in the book of Genesis had been reasonable, but it exploded way beyond anything that I had ever imagined. Lectures were never a place where you came to catch up on your Bible reading. In his first lecture, he urged us to read and read the text. For years to come, in response to our repeated inquiries about how to grapple with the Bible for ourselves and as teachers, he would answer, "Just read it. Let it define the questions as well as the answers." For Frank, it was too important a book and too complex a book to yield its spiritual truths to some neat expository paradigm. The Bible was a living instrument. Read it and let its thinking take hold of you. Frank's obvious scholarliness blinded me at the start to his very warm humanity. Later, however, this was evident in every interaction with him. His practical skills in cooking, caring for the kids, and general day-to-day housekeeping displayed wonderful down-to-earth family man. Such became much clearer still when he renamed their new residence at Ridley, formerly christened Wade Lodge, as Wade Inn. Was he quietly foisting the mantle of yet more hospitality on Lois and on the kids? If so, I never sensed any complaints. Maybe it was just a reference to the vast scatter of paper in his study into which you entered of paper around the study. The room was littered with it. This mildly jocular informality was just Frank. When I came to us to stay with us, he, Lars and the five kids showed that they knew how to relax as a family, to picnic, to leisure, to do all the things that family do. We learnt very early Frank and Lars's commitment to the skill. Skills at card game called 500. Frank had an outrageous habit of occasionally making impossible bids. Trouble was, he won too far many hands based on these bids, far too many for the comfort of the rest of us. But whatever, win or lose, the outcome was hilarity all round and very much led by Frank. When Frank was appointed to a position at Macquarie University, he and the family settled in Epping, not far from where we lived. Many the happy gatherings that followed. Now, further to our delight, after some looking around, the family joined our local church. Frank very quickly became part of the local ministry team. He loved teaching ordinary people from his favourite book. As we talked more, it became clear that life had become a bit hard for him and for the family. He'd left a senior teaching role at the Divinity School of the Redeemer in California to take up the headship of a college elsewhere in the world. It had quickly emerged that he had irreconcilable differences with the board, and he and they had parted company. So the move to Macquarie was not part of the original plan, however welcome he was made to feel, and however much he welcomed it himself. He published his commentary on the Book of Job in the Tyndale Commentary Series in the early 1970s. My copy has the first edition dated as 1976, though the date on the author's preface is, and I quote, St. Andrew's Day, 1974. Frank was always one for precision. Wikipedia records his arrival at Macquarie University as 1975. So, having written about the book of the Old Testament that dealt with unexpected, even inexplicable grief and loss, he had had cause through the post-California events to reflect on what he had just written. Perhaps even before his words had been seen, had seen the light of public gaze. He so wanted the Bible's understanding to reach an ordinary world. Very sadly and regrettably, worse loss was to come. It came in the totally unheralded and untimely death of the youngest of their three sons. Martin, for all of us, the loss of this talented young man was hard to fathom. For years to come, Frank criticised himself for what he perceived as a lack of real empathy for sufferers in his commentary. Many of us found his work much less worthy of criticism. Somewhere around 10 years ago, Frank completed a very substantial revision of his commentary, informed not only by his own experiences, but also informed by the reactions of generations of students, themselves young Christians working caring professions with whom he shared the text of Job. The revision has never been published in English, but I am glad to say that I understand a translation into Japanese has been published in Japan. Grief and loss. I come to my own personal feelings at the loss of a greatly valued friend and always my teacher. Perhaps with Job I might find grace enough to mouth his words, "The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away." They're true enough, but not always very satisfying. But as I reflect on Frank, his godliness of life, his love for his Lord, and his friendship and kindness and leadership to so many of us, I can without reserve say the words that follow. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Conversations with a close and trusted friend have no boundaries. Borders disappear. Talking with Frank was like that. Whenever we met, small talk somehow stood little chance. With Frank, it shriveled almost immediately. Whatever the topic, in at the deep end. That's what happened when I shared with him a draft of the song we are about to sing. It had been months in the making. The full version has 7 stanzas. It was, I now felt, ready for his critique. I think you would agree that the cosmos itself seems to know Frank's passion for ancient languages. A passion inseparable from his love of poetry, be it Emily Dickinson, Thomas Merton, or the Hebrew Bible soaked as it is in the poems of prophet and bard, of love song and psalm. So, within seconds, with Margaret sitting beside me, Frank was analysing my song. Floor in metre, need for a different word, the rearrangement of a clause, a twist to the syntax. Beloved Frank, how many of us treasure the memory of long discussions, your loyal and constant friendship, your affirmation and encouragement, and your unflinchingly candid, invaluable critiques that allowed us to return to our work with greater insight, renewed energy, and grittier integrity? Now, as we bid you farewell, we do so knowing that your signature, your presence, is like sunlight on these sung lines as we sing them into new being. For each other and for you, dear Frank.
Let songs of earth ring out. I first visited Frank and Lois when I was a student minister at Donvale Presbyterian Church in 2007. And when I remained as a pastor there, I was blessed by the many visits to Frank and Lois, and then to Frank, and then to Frank and Margaret over the years up until 2018. I thank God for the way that Frank, as he asked me to call him when I went to say professor, the way he used, I thank the Lord for the way he used Frank to grow my knowledge of God's word as I listened much. The Lord stretched my, I used Frank to stretch me in my theological thinking, to spur me to read more widely and to read God's word more closely, even in Greek and Hebrew. And he encouraged me to trust in and love my Saviour and God more. And I was blessed seeing Frank's persevering faith through many a trial. So join me now, please, as we pray and give God thanks. Lord God and gracious Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise supremely for the love and grace you've shown us in Jesus Christ. Thank you for saving Frank Anderson through the Lord Jesus, who is the resurrection and the life. And when we believe in him, we live even though we die. We praise you, Almighty God, that because Jesus died and rose again and our Redeemer lives, Frank is now with you in glory in the presence of his Saviour. We thank you, Father, that Frank has fought the good fight, finished the race and kept the faith, and now there is in store for him the crown of righteousness. We say thanks be to God that you've given Frank and all your people the victory over sin and death and the grave through our Lord Jesus. Gracious Father, we thank you for the love and care that Frank showed to Lois over their 58 years of marriage, to his children, stepchildren, John and Deborah, David and Suri, Martin, Nidra and Stephen and Catherine, and to his beloved 6 grandchildren. Bless them each, we pray. Thank you for his 5 years of marriage to Margaret. We pray for your peace and blessing upon Margaret, her children and grandchildren too. We thank you for the husband and father, the father-in-law and grandfather he was, Papa, and the stepfather and brother and uncle. We thank you, as we've heard today, for the friend he was to so many, the colleague, the teacher, and the mentor. Thank you for his love, his humility, his humour, the way he encouraged us. We thank you, Almighty God, for the wisdom and knowledge that you gave to Frank, his knowledge of you and of your word, Lord, his knowledge of multiple languages. Thank you for the gifts of teaching you gave him, for the ways his scholarly work and his words, spoken and written, so taught and encouraged others to know and trust the Lord as their Creator, their Redeemer, and the one who is love. Thank you that for the way, Lord, that you used him to equip others to teach your word. Thank you for his many years of faithful service to the Church of the Lord Jesus, the Anglican Church, and beyond, and indeed ultimately to the kingdom of God. Thank you that by the Holy Spirit you enabled Frank to persevere through many trials, times of darkness, despair, illness and hardships, mental and physical. Thank you that by your grace he persevered in faith to the end. Thank you that the weakness and pain and weariness of body has now ended, and that he has entered the joyful presence of his Lord. Thank you, Father, that in your power and love you can enable your children to grieve with hope. And we pray that all of Frank's loved ones, his family and friends and family in Christ, would know grace to grieve with hope. Give them comfort and peace, we pray. We thank you for the legacy of faith we see in the lives of Frank's family and his students. continue to bear fruit through them and through us all, that we may bear witness to the love, grace, and faithfulness of Frank's God, who is our God, and the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. We'll pray together the words of the Lord's Prayer. As our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as in heaven. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We are the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord always be with you always.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life. And in your keeping are all who have departed in Christ. And we here commit the body of our dear brother Frank to your care. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who died and was buried and rose again for us, and who shall change our mortal body that it may be like his glorious body. Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And please stand for the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.